Welcome. This is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is Exploration. Every week in Exploration, we discuss the fascinating world of science and its impact on society. And today, leading off, we're going to summarize some of the top stories of the past week. Well, I was hoping to lead off the new year with some good news, but unfortunately, we have some bad news leading off in today's broadcast. First of all, NASA scientists have been looking at the oceans. The oceans, of course, give you an average assessment of what's happening with the entire planet. You can't do that by looking at the rainforests of the Amazon or the deserts of Africa, because weather is localized there. But when you look at the oceans, you get the average effect. And what people find is that by 2100, sea levels will rise a full 12 inches. And that could cause catastrophic weather changes around the world. NASA scientists also analyzed the South Pole. And they realized that the South Pole, well, it's heating up six times faster than it did 40 years ago. So we now think that the South Pole, which was once thought to be the bedrock, the very foundation of stability of the Earth's atmosphere, is heating up to the point where we might see more cracks, more gigantic ice shelves breaking off from the South Pole, and that in turn could affect your weather. And then let's say a few things about, well, outer space. The History Channel, as I pointed out last week, has a new series called Project Blue Book about the secret plans by the United States military to analyze thousands of UFO sightings. Well, reviewers have had a chance to look at some of the episodes, so we'll say a few things about how accurate is the History Channel's TV program about Project Blue Book, the plan by the United States military over the years to analyze thousands of UFO sightings. And then moving on, talking about the planet Earth, we'll also say some things about the pole shift. You know, some people think that the North and the South Pole will one day shift or merge or move, and as a consequence, destroy the Earth. Well, it turns out that the magnetic North is, in fact, moving much faster than people thought. In fact, it's moving at 34 miles per year, much faster than before. It doesn't mean that hell's going to break loose. However, scientists are scratching their heads as to why the magnetic north is moving so fast. And then we'll say a few things about genomics and our human ancestors. As we reported on Exploration, we now know that not just the Neanderthals lived with Homo sapiens thousands of years ago. We have also the Denisovans who lived in Siberia. But now there's a possibility of a third hominid that coexisted with us tens of thousands of years ago. And this one was found by looking at the genome of Asian people. By using artificial intelligence, by learning systems called deep learning, we were able to actually analyze the genomes of Asian people and find remnants of yet another inbreeding that took place in our family tree. And also, speaking about genomics, how long are you going to live? Well, we know that the insurance companies have actuarial charts where they begin to estimate how long you're going to live, and they bet on it. The insurance industry, in fact, is betting on how long you're going to live and how accurate these actuarial charts are. Well, these charts simply look at how old you are and your habits like smoking and diet. However, what about looking at your genes? Well, it turns out that the University of Edinburgh is doing exactly that. Not just looking at your smoking rate and how much you drink, but also looking at your genomes, and it comes out with some rather interesting results. Well, let's just jump right into the top stories of the past week. As I mentioned, I was hoping to start off the new year, 2019, with some good news, but it turns out there's more bad news concerning global warming. First of all, there's a myth often perpetuated by the skeptics, that says that for the past 15 years, global warming has come to a halt and even slowed down. So what's all this fuss about? Well, you have to be very careful about this because a lot of the projections about global warming are done by looking at the terrestrial weather, land. However, land changes every time you go from one region to another. We have the deserts of the Sahara. We have the lush forests of the Amazons. However, when you look at the oceans, you get a much clearer idea of what's happening with the temperature of the Earth because the oceans average any anomaly in the weather. So if there is a hot spot or a cold spot someplace on the planet Earth, it doesn't affect the average temperature because everything washes out. Well, it turns out that NASA scientists are looking now at the most precise way of looking at the temperature of the Earth. And by looking at the temperature of the oceans, you can also predict sea level rise. It turns out that sea level rises are due to two basic factors. The largest factor is the thermal expansion of water. When water heats up, it expands. It expands at a known rate. And that gives us a very accurate average understanding of the rise of temperature. Second of all, of course, you have melting of the ice. I'll talk about that separately. So first of all, when you look at sea level rise, so the latest results are that by the year 2100, sea levels will rise an additional 12 inches. Now just remember that for every vertical inch of the beachfront that you lose 100 horizontal inches of the beach itself. So this means that we're talking about a change in the geography of the planet Earth. And as the Earth heats up, it means we're going to have more storms, more hurricanes. First of all, where does the energy of a hurricane come from? The fantastic energy of a hurricane comes from warm water. Warm water causes hot air to rise, and the Earth spins beneath it, giving a spiral effect, and bingo, you get a hurricane. And so we're going to see perhaps hurricanes of greater intensity because of the fact that the ocean temperature is rising much faster than we previously thought. Now, sea levels will also rise for a second reason, and that is the polar ice caps are also gradually beginning to melt. First of all, NASA scientists were rather shocked to find that by analyzing temperature from 1979 to 2017, sea levels rose by an extra half an inch during that period of time because of global warming. Now, they know this by looking at pictures from satellites and also pictures taken from airplanes. Now, the fact that the Earth is heating up also means that the loss of ice in the South Pole has accelerated by a factor of 6 over the last 40 years. From 1979 to 1990, the South Pole lost 48 billion tons in 1 year. Well, it turns out that when you look at the results recently, it's now 252 billion tons of ice lost per year. And of course, that loss of ice means more sea level rise. And again, with the rising of sea level, you're going to have more monster storms throwing water into cities and, of course, paralyzing things like the subway system. And also, sea level rise means that certain island nations will gradually disappear. And it means that, well, I live in Manhattan, and it means that Wall Street may one day have to have dikes and levees surrounding it to protect it from rising sea levels. And so watch out. By looking at the temperature of the oceans, we get a much better picture of the average effect of how the Earth is heating up. Well, let's also say a few things about a story I covered last week, and that is Project Blue Book. Project Blue Book was a program that was started after World War II because of the rash of UFO sightings, and they had actually a scientist in charge of it who was supposed to, well, debunk most of these sightings. But out of thousands of sightings, about 700 still could not be explained using the known laws of physics and using the known technologies that was found in the 1950s. And so we're at a situation where the guy who led the project, who was more or less told by his superiors to sweep everything under the rug, he went from being a skeptic to being a believer in the mystery of UFOs. And then the question is, now that reviewers have had a chance to look at the episodes, how accurate is the History Channel? Well, first of all, let's be blunt. The History Channel did, of course, use special effects to accentuate certain things, to fill in the gaps. Eyewitness accounts are often sketchy, often self-contradictory, and, well, that's where the special effects guy comes in. So don't be surprised if you see Hollywood-level special effects when you're looking at eyewitness accounts of UFOs. However, there's one place where a lot of reviewers criticize the History Channel program. The guy who led the study in one sequence is shown with the aliens themselves. The aliens themselves were died in a crash, and there he is inspecting the bodies of the aliens. There is no evidence in the record at all that that episode actually happened. Now, we should also point out that Blue Book was just the first of several attempts by the military to analyze UFOs, and the attitude of the military changed over time. The attitude of the military at first was to poo-poo these studies, but then it changed, and then the military began to actually encourage these kinds of UFO sightings because it deflected attention away from the stealth bomber and other kinds of experimental aircraft that were being experimented with at Area 51. And so, in other words, the Air Force actually went along with it and encouraged the mythology of UFOs because it meant that it had a way to cover its own top secret program of developing these kinds of systems. However, one should also point out that if you read the internal documents of the United States Air Force, it does in fact realize that potentially UFOs could pose a security risk to the United States. And since the military was entrusted with our defense and security, it means that, well, yes, there were voices in the military that said that, well, even though most of these things are fake, some of them could pose a threat to national security. And so the fact that the government kept these studies going for decades, even after Project Blue Book was shut down, is not surprising, because the military was entrusted with keeping everyone safe, even from aliens from outer space. Now, my personal point of view is that recently another batch of these sightings was released by the Pentagon. And some of these sightings look, well, they look pretty authentic, pretty hard to dismiss. We're talking about radar sightings by radar and by visual means of objects that seem to whiz across the sky, make gyrations that are unbelievable, and things that are beyond what we can do with our own aircraft. Well, personally, I think that there is a case to be made that a lot of these sightings originate from the black arts division of the military. Of course, we had the stealth bomber, a bomber that was tested in the desert to make sure that it could evade ground radar. But now we have yet another type of weapon systems being experimented with by the Pentagon, also the Russians, also the Chinese, and that is hypersonic drones. These are objects which can go between Mach 5 and Mach 20, that is between 5 and 20 times the speed of sound. And the main thing is that they are maneuverable. That's one reason why it's taken so long to perfect them. Now, if the United States perfects a Star Wars system, the Russians are not going to take this lying down. They want to evade the ground radar of a Star Wars system by making their missiles maneuverable. But that's the problem. You see, if you're traveling at Mach 5 to Mach 20, and you're entering the atmosphere, the slightest vibration that is not accounted for can make your airplane spiral out of control and crash. That's exactly what happened to the attempts by the United States military. 2 years ago, its hypersonic program was actually canceled because of the instability of these missiles traveling at such a high velocity in air. Now, in outer space, of course, There's no problems with maneuvering because there's no air in outer space. There's no friction. But once you hit the atmosphere of the planet Earth on reentry, that's where all the difficulties come in. And that's why the United States program was actually shut down 2 years ago. Now, the Russians, just last year, Vladimir Putin boasted that they have perfected the hypersonic drone. Well, that was met with a certain amount of skepticism on the part of the United States. However, most analysts would say that, well, yeah, the Russians are perhaps a little bit ahead of us in terms of perfecting this technology, but it's a lot harder than most people realize. So don't think there's going to be a hypersonic gap anytime soon. We should also point that on the medical front, certain advances have been made in terms of filling out the blanks in our family tree. We realized, of course, going back decades ago, that we humans coexisted with, well, Neanderthals that inhabited northern Europe tens of thousands of years ago, along with Homo sapiens. We've sequenced their genes. And then several years ago, the Denisovans were discovered. The Denisovans we found not by looking at their bones, but by looking at a tooth and extracting DNA from it and finding out that yet another branch of humanity coexisted with us tens of thousands of years ago. And now perhaps a third hominid ancestor has been found using computers. That's right. Artificial intelligence has been applied to the human genome to look for patterns consistent with inbreeding between Homo sapiens and yet another hominid species. And this forces us to rewrite the history of the human race. Now, if you see the movie Our Lord of the Rings, you realize that humans in the movie coexist with dwarves and elves and orcs and all sorts of mythical creatures. Well, now we begin to realize that perhaps our family tree is a little bit like Lord of the Rings. Also, here's another question. How long are you going to live? Well, the insurance companies, of course, spend millions of dollars trying to perfect the black arts of predicting when you're going to die. They use questionnaires. They use blood tests, physical exams to figure out your habits and whether or not you're going to come down with cancer or heart disease. However, what about using your genes to do this? Well, traditionally, it was too difficult to do this because not many people have had their genes sequenced. But now it's almost a fad to have your genes sequenced. So at the University of Edinburgh in Scotland, they analyzed the genomes of 500,000 people. And then they compared it with the lifespan of their parents. And then they got a correlation between genes and habits and lifespan. Of course, this is not deterministic. You can't accurately predict one individual's lifespan. But on average, you can, in fact, make certain conclusions from this. They singled out several genes which seemed to indicate a high correlation with longevity. And by plotting this, they then calculated that the top 10% of people with healthy genes lived on average 5 years longer than people at the bottom 10%. Now, we should also point out that they looked at the genes. This means they did not look at smoking, bad habits, being overweight, not exercising. And they, of course, will also affect your ultimate life expectancy. But what they did was to look at the genes to find out, is there something you inherited from your parents that could then predict longevity? Well, the results are still being crunched. However, we'll announce the results when they come out. We should also point out that in the future, this may allow scientists to one day find the fountain of youth. Now, let me explain. Now that millions of people are having their genes sequenced, it means that one day scientists will take the genes of old people, scan them, and also the genes of young people, scan them, and subtract, and find out where most of the wear and tear and most of the aging takes place in the human genome. For example, take a car. Where does aging take place in a car? Well, it takes place in the engine. Why? That's where you have moving parts. That's where you have combustion, the buildup of deposits, oxidation. And that's where much of the aging is concentrated. Now, what is the engine of the cell? The engine of the cell is the mitochondria. That's where energy is burnt. That's where the cell burns glucose to get energy to perform bodily functions. Now, this means that by looking at the genes of mitochondria, we expect to find errors, error buildup, because of the wear and tear and the combustion that takes place in the mitochondria. And bingo, that's exactly what we do find. We do find that damage to the genes seems to be concentrated in a few areas, including the mitochondria, and that leads us to believe that one day we'll be able to fix those genes. Because, well, what is aging? Of course, there have been many theories of aging over the centuries, but scientists are more or less converging on the idea that aging is the buildup of errors in our genes, mistakes in our cells, mistakes in our molecules. The buildup of all these mistakes eventually make the cells sluggish. They don't perform like they used to. And as a consequence of this, aging takes place and eventually you die. In fact, that's why we die. Now, if you can reverse the process using gene therapy to fix those broken genes, then perhaps the cell can be rejuvenated and perhaps we'll have a fountain of youth. Of course, that's just a dream, but it's a dream that is based on what is known about science at the present time. And speaking about aging, you know the Earth is also aging right before our eyes. Look at the poles, the North Pole and the South Pole. Most people think that they are a permanent feature of the planet Earth, but no, they move. The North Pole and the South Pole actually migrate, and the migration factor is accelerating. Scientists were a little bit surprised to find that the North Pole, the magnetic North Pole in Canada, is moving faster than expected. It used to move about 9 miles per year. And so, in other words, if you have a map of the Earth, you have, of course, the geologic North Pole around which the Earth spins, but then you have the magnetic North Pole where compass needles points, and that's located in northern Canada. But it moves about 9 miles per year. The latest evidence is that it moves 34 miles per year, much faster than expected, and we don't know why. First of all, it does affect map makers because the military and commercial shipping do in fact use not only GPS, but also the magnetic north, and we have to recalibrate it. We have to recalibrate the actual location of magnetic north. Now, why is it moving? It has something to do with the inside of the Earth, but sadly, we scientists are clueless as to being able to predict and understand the motion of the North Poles. Now, the North Pole and the South Pole sometimes even flip. We know this by going to Hawaii, digging right into the lava flows, and over the millennia, when lava cools down and freezes, it freezes the direction of magnetic north in the lava. And so by simply getting a compass needle and analyzing the direction of North Pole frozen in the lava, you can actually see, as you go millions of years into the past, the fact that the poles have in fact moved. Well, they're moving again. In fact, they're decreasing in intensity. That's right. The strength of the North Pole is decreasing in intensity and one day may go down to zero. At that point, things get a little bit dangerous because a solar wind can thereby affect the Earth and bathe the Earth in high-intensity radiation. However, this has happened in the past. We came through it. Perhaps it accelerated our mutation rate to have so much ultraviolet radiation from the sun, but we lived through it. And if it happens again, well, we'll have to get protection, more than just sunglasses. And lastly, let me say a few things about my field, which is high-energy physics. It turns out that the Europeans want to build a replacement for the Large Hadron Collider. As you know, the Large Hadron Collider is this gigantic machine, 100 kilometers in circumference, built outside Geneva, Switzerland. It's an atom smasher that smashes protons together at a maximum energy of 14 trillion electron volts, and it discovered the Higgs boson, the last missing piece of what we call the Standard Model. And the Europeans want to bet on yet another, more improved version of the Large Hadron Collider, even bigger than the previous one. In fact, the new one is going to be about four times bigger, perhaps have an energy of 10 times the energy of the Large Hadron Collider. And of course, this is not cheap. We're talking about perhaps $27 billion for the machine. Now, of course, it's not guaranteed that the European Union is going to cough up that amount of money, but scientists are beginning to look what is called beyond the Standard Model. The Standard Model is a very ugly theory of the atom. However, it is the most advanced understanding of the universe. The Standard Model is what is called the theory of almost everything. We see no deviation from the Standard Model, except it misses gravity. That's right, the other great theory of science, Einstein's theory of gravity, is not included in the discussion of the Standard Model. However, there is a theory called string theory, which is what I do for a living. That's my day job, working on string theory. And it predicts a new set of particles beyond the Large Hadron Collider. And that's where the Future Circular Collider comes in, the FCC. The FCC would be perhaps a replacement for the Large Hadron Collider. It will perhaps discover dark matter in the laboratory. We now realize that dark matter makes up most of the universe. Most of the universe is not made out of atoms. Most of the universe is made out of this elusive dark matter. And the FCC, the Future Circular Collider, which would be 50 to 62 miles long, may in fact have enough energy to discover this missing piece. And it is a piece that is predicted by string theory. String theory predicts that all matter consists of tiny vibrating strings. The next octave of the string, we think, could be dark matter. And that, of course, could open up a whole new era in physics with the discovery of a new form of matter, stable matter, matter beyond atomic physics, and that is dark matter, which we hope to create with the Large Hadron Collider. Well, I'm afraid that's it for the first part of exploration. In the second part of exploration, we're going to continue our discussion of what happens when the South Pole begins to melt and break up. Our special guest is David Archer, and the book is called The Long Thaw. In other words, what happens if one day the poles begin to melt because of global warming? And if you want a copy of today's program, call the Pacifica Program Service at 1-800-735-0230 for a copy of today's program. Stay tuned. Welcome. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is the second half of Exploration. In the first half of Exploration, we gave you the dark news about the fact that the South Pole is heating up six times faster than previously thought, and the temperature of the oceans is rising. Sea levels are going to be rising and accelerating into the future because of global warming. Well, with us today to talk to a climatologist about this is David Archer, author of the book The Long Thaw, and he'll walk us through what's going to happen if one day the North and the South Pole begins to melt and all sorts of havoc takes place in the atmosphere of the Earth. And so once again, we're not talking about something that's going to happen tomorrow. These are long-term changes, but satellites and airplane photographs and measurements indicate that, well, all arrows point up. The fact that temperatures are rising, the fact that melting of the Antarctic is accelerating, the fact that weather changes are going to be increasing as we go into the future. And just remember that the oceans control most of the weather on the planet Earth. So as the weathers of the pole begin to change, your weather can change as well. For example, think of the polar vortex. The polar vortex is this hurricane on top of the North Pole, and it's beginning to wander. It's not so stable anymore, this hurricane at the very top of the North Pole, and it begins to affect the jet stream. And when the jet stream is affected, wow, watch out. That's when you get snowstorms. That's when you get droughts. That's when you get the whole weather of the United States being affected when the jet stream starts to wobble out of control. And so once again, our special guest in the second half of Exploration is David Archer. The topic is the long thaw. Now I'd like to introduce our special guest for today. He's Professor David Archer, Professor of Geophysical Sciences at the University of Chicago, and he's the author of a rather disturbing new book, and it's called The Long Thaw, How Humans Are Changing the Next 100,000 Years of Earth's Climate. He argues in The Long Thaw that not only are humans ruining the atmosphere of the Earth by dumping copious quantities of carbon dioxide, but the effects of this will linger in the atmosphere, not just for years, not just for centuries, but 100,000 years. And what does it mean? What does it mean for us to live in a world with that much carbon dioxide and that much global warming? So once again, the special guest is Dr. David Archer of the University of Chicago. The book is called The Long Thaw. Professor Archer, as a youth, how did you first get interested in science, and in particular, earth science?
I guess I looked to the earth, the functioning of the earth, the stable geochemical cycles of things like that, as something that's bigger than people are. I look to the natural world with a sort of reverence, and I think that's what brought me into the natural sciences, why I chose to study the oceans, actually, instead of forests or other planets or stars or something like that, is because I've always had a romantic love of boats, but now I ended up living in Chicago anyway, but that's just one of life's jokes, I guess.
Okay, well, let's get right into it. First of all, what is the relationship between carbon dioxide and global warming?
Well, carbon dioxide traps infrared light that tries to leave the atmosphere. It's like if you put a coat on in the wintertime, it traps some of the heat leaving your body, and so it allows your body to warm up. And the theory about CO2, how it affects the climate of the Earth and how much it affects the climate of the Earth, is over 100 years old now. It's very, very solid science. If there were no greenhouse effect, we wouldn't be able to explain why the Earth isn't in a deep freeze or the climate of Venus or lots of other things. It's very solid science.
And, well, talking about Venus, some people call Venus the greenhouse planet. Why would a carbon dioxide atmosphere for Venus make it the greenhouse planet?
Well, there's 70 atmospheres of CO2 in the atmosphere of Venus, so it's very, very thick greenhouse forcing. It has a very strong greenhouse effect. Actually, Venus is also a very reflective planet. That's why it's so bright in the night sky. So if there were no greenhouse effect on either Earth or Mars, even though Venus is closer to the sun, it would be colder than the Earth because it reflects away so much of the sunlight that would heat it up.
Okay, well, now let me play devil's advocate. Some people say, bah, humbug. The current warming of the Earth is a natural cycle. The Earth is naturally warming up. Other people say that it's the sun. Yeah, the sun. The sun is causing the Earth to rise in temperature, not human activity. And other people say that the Earth is cooling. What are your thoughts?
Sometimes it's even the same people who one year say the Earth is not warming up and the next year say that it's warming up, but it's entirely natural. You know, ours is a contentious species. We tend to take both sides of positions, even if there's nothing to base assertions on. If they sound good, they still can carry some weight. The Earth has clearly been getting warmer. That's measured, even though it's been a cool summer here in Chicago. Overall, the average temperature of the Earth is rising. The sun has not been getting brighter. We have good measurements of the intensity of the sun from satellites going back a few decades. I don't know exactly, but it's not there. There's a sunspot cycle that makes the sun brighter and cooler over 11 years, but there isn't a long-term trend at all in the sun getting brighter. So, you know, people say what they, you know, think people want to hear, and they people hear what they want to hear, but there is, you know, objective reality. We can measure these things and say what's really going on.
Okay. Well, some of the critics say, okay, so maybe the Earth is getting warmer. However, human activity, some people would say, no, it's not human activity. So what's the reason that many scientists believe that it's human activity causing the current warming?
We can estimate how much warming to expect from rising CO2 concentrations in the air. That's actually boiled down into a number called the climate sensitivity, which is how much the climate would warm if you doubled the CO2 concentration. And the first estimate of the climate sensitivity of the Earth actually goes back to Svante Arrhenius in the year 1896, over 100 years ago, who predicted that doubling CO2 should raise the temperature of the Earth by about 6 degrees centigrade. And now they say it's something like 2.5 to 5 degrees centigrade. It's really not that much of a change. It's a tricky calculation because it's very complex the way that CO2 interacts with light. But this is by sort of normal non-political rules of science, this is a done question.
So let's say we're to remove humanity from the planet Earth, then you're saying that the Earth would not be so warm as it is today?
There was a model exercise conducted by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. So these are climate models developed all over the world. And they all subjected their models to one scenario where you tell the models about the rising concentrations of greenhouse gases, and then another scenario where you only have the natural climate forcings like the intensity of the sun or volcanic eruptions can cool down the planet. And if you tell the models about the greenhouse gases, they can explain the warming that has been detected since sort of the 1970s. The warming, the temperature since the 1970s, that's the smoking gun for global warming. If you don't tell the models about the greenhouse gases, they don't warm up in the same way. So if you want to say that the warming is real, but it's caused by, you know, something that we don't understand in the climate system, which, you know, there will always be things that we don't understand, not only would you like to come up with an explanation of what that something would be in order to settle the question, but you would also have to figure out why the CO2 is not causing the warming that we attribute it to. It's sort of like if you catch, I make an analogy in my classes to a murder mystery, because people always put on their thinking caps when they're reading murder mysteries. They don't always put on thinking caps when they're thinking about science. But so you catch the butler with a gun in his hand and the dead guy, and there's, you know, smoke coming out of the gun, and your partner is sort of a contrarian guy. You're a policeman trying to to, you know, solve the crime. Your partner says, well, I think the chauffeur did it. But, you know, for your partner to convict the chauffeur, he's first going to have to explain to the jury what the butler was doing with the smoking gun in his hand. In other words, translating back out of the analogy, if we want to say that the warming is not from CO2, we have to explain what's wrong with greenhouse theory, that the CO2 should not be causing the warming.
Well, if you look at temperature rises over the last many centuries, you see a gradual warming, because after all, there was an ice age 10,000 years ago. But some scientists say that there's a spike that is quite anomalous that is taking place in the last 100 years, and that's proof that it's human activity because it's not part of the natural cycle. What are your thoughts?
Well, there is this large-scale glacial-interglacial cycle that you refer to. There's also a sort of a milder, much shorter, I don't know if it's a cycle or just sort of fluctuations, but back sort of between the 1300s and the 1700s was a time of generally cool temperatures called the Little Ice Age. So you could, you know, ice skate in Amsterdam and things like that that you no longer can do. And that is correlated with a lack of sunspots, which indicates that the sun was cooler. We don't have satellite solar intensity data going back to the 1600s, but we have observations of a number of sunspots that date back to, you know, Galileo's invention of the telescope in the 1600s, and there's a correlation between the number of sunspots and those sorts of climate changes. I think the evolution of climate up until the 70s, though, can be explained pretty well by natural forcings. It isn't until the 70s that the climate signal started to, the human-forced climate signal started to come up out of the noise of natural variability.
Now, also, some people say that the last decade was perhaps the hottest decade ever recorded. How far back does that go? Because, of course, perhaps during the dinosaur era, things were a lot warmer back then.
Sure. So there are thermometer records that go back to about 1860 from Fahrenheit's invention of the thermometer. They can piece together the temperature of the Earth going back further than that with what they call proxy records of temperature from the widths of tree rings or from chemical measurements they can make in ice cores or sediment cores or something like that. And so they can record, they can figure out that the Little Ice Age was cooler, and then there was a period of general warmth before that called the medieval optimum climate. Those records generally go back 1,000 or 2,000 years, and the conclusion of the last IPCC report, which summarized climate, you know, for non-specialists and for, you know, for the community outside of your own field, very useful, very, very authoritative reports. They concluded that current temperatures are warmer than they have been in 1,300 years. But if you go back millions of years, you're absolutely right. Peaking about 50 million years ago, the Earth was it felt tropical to the poles, and there was no ice anywhere to be found. And this is thought to be due to higher CO2 levels in the atmosphere at that time. We don't have as good ways of estimating what the CO2 concentration was when you go that far back in time, but the evidence that has been pieced together is all consistent, that there's sort of million-year or tens of million-year fluctuations in the natural CO2 levels of the Earth that sort of drifts up and down like that.
Now, scientists that have gone to the poles to extract ice cores, essentially getting ice that was deposited perhaps several hundred thousand years ago to maybe a million years ago,
yes,
they see that carbon dioxide levels and temperature levels go up and down in unison like two roller coasters. What does that mean?
It's rare that you find such beautiful correlations in nature, I think. It's just astonishing. Al Gore showed this plot in his movie. That's sort of how iconic it is. It's an astonishing thing.
So, Professor Archer, ice core data shows that carbon dioxide levels go up and down.
But the temperature of the Earth goes up and down, and the two of them go up and down like two synchronized roller coasters. So what does that mean if the ups and downs of carbon dioxide exactly mirror the ups and downs of temperatures on the Earth.
Somehow, the orbit of the Earth around the Sun has these wobbles in it, and that is thought to pace the progress of the ice age cycle, when the ice sheets are going to grow or when they're going to collapse. But somehow, the CO2 concentration of the air follows along with the changes in the climate, so that when the orbit tells the ice sheet to make the Earth warmer, the CO2 says, okay, I can pitch in some to that too, and so it amplifies these climate changes.
So which comes first? The temperature rise comes first, and then the carbon dioxide rise, vice versa? What's the relationship?
It's a back and forth cause and effect. It's a feedback system. So to ask which one is driving which, I think, is like asking if you see two figure skaters, you know, twirling each other around on the ice, to try to analyze the trajectory of one without paying attention to the other would make no sense. On the deglaciation, the transition from the ice age climate to the present day climate, the first thing that started to happen, as recorded in the Antarctic ice cores, is a change in temperature in Antarctica. And then a few centuries later, the CO2 concentration started to rise. But then the total change in climate took much longer than a few centuries. So there's no way you could explain the climate transition from the glacial world to the interglacial world without taking into account the change in the CO2 concentration. So it's a feedback loop of cause and effect. It isn't just one or the other drives the thing.
So summarizing, if you were to go back 10,000 years, we had the Ice Age. Things have been warming up in the last 10,000 years. But is it safe to say that recently, in the last several decades, there's been a spike in temperature rise, and that's due to human activity?
That's more or less true. Actually, the interglacial period is called the Holocene. And the early Holocene, right at about 10,000 to 6,000 or 8,000 years ago, may have been warmer than today. The Earth's orbit around the Sun was in a different, you know, slightly different configuration than it is today. So it almost seemed like there was a peak in warming and then maybe a little bit of gradual decline driven by the Earth's orbit over the millennia. But certainly over the last 1,000 years or two, the temperatures of the last decade are anomalously high.
Okay, let's talk about the present. What's happening with glaciers and the North Pole and the South Pole? We see evidence of the melting of the glaciers around the Earth. That's why scientists are finding so many mammoth bones and even human remains, because the glaciers are receding. So what evidence do we have that the Earth is warming?
Well, we just have the thermometers. I mean, for direct measurements of temperature, thermometers are hard to beat. But the mountain glaciers are almost all melting. It's difficult for a glaciology graduate student to find an advancing mountain glacier to study anymore, because there are very few that exist. There's warming detected in the deep ocean. Fairly deep, not all the way to the bottom of the ocean, but you can see the warmth sort of penetrating the ocean. In the high latitudes, the Arctic is melting like crazy. It's the sea ice covering the Arctic Ocean is melting much faster than any of the models a few years ago predicted. The year 2007 was a sort of a train wreck for the sea ice up there. It just plummeted. Actually, in the southern hemisphere, it's not so clear what's going on. In the interior of Antarctica, it actually is cooling, which is not, that's something that the climate models also predict. So that's not a discrepancy. But there's also not been a melt back in the sea ice in the Antarctic either. And I gather there's still some messiness about that issue, that maybe it's caused by changes in the circulation of the atmosphere caused by the ozone hole, which is a completely different sort of phenomenon. Ozone is a greenhouse gas, but it also absorbs ultraviolet light, and so it heats up the air that it's in the stratosphere. That's why the stratosphere gets warmer as you go higher up in the stratosphere because of ozone. So by wiping out the ozone in the spring of the Antarctic every year, that changes the dynamics of the air, and maybe that's responsible for a lack of global warming signature generally in the southern hemisphere. Actually, there has been very intense warming on the Antarctic Peninsula, which kind of sticks out from Antarctica up into the slightly lower latitudes. And so you read sometimes in the newspapers about these ice shelves, these very thick floating shelves of ice, hundreds of meters thick. You could walk on it and not know that you weren't on solid land, that suddenly have been collapsing. Places that have been covered by ice for, you know, since the last ice age, suddenly are ice free. So there are signs of the climate change every place. The growing seasons have gotten longer. The Arbor Day Foundation has published maps of climate zones of where you should plant begonias or tulips or whatever, and those have changed since 1990. There are all kinds of signs. It's more obvious in some parts of the world than others. Actually, in Chicago, there hasn't been much climate change since the 70s, but if you go up to Alaska, the climate changes have been huge. So, you know, local experience is not necessarily a good guide, but you put it together into a global average, and it's very clear.
And also, you mentioned how it affects plants and also animals with the changing of the growing season, but also insects, right? Some people are saying that the West Nile virus, which has been spreading through urban centers, is in part driven by global warming, and then the future, malaria could also spread. What are your thoughts?
I'm not a public health person. I don't really know a lot about the details of this, but people that I talk to are very concerned about the effects of climate on public health. I think the World Health Organization estimated last year that there are 150,000 deaths a year that can be attributed to climate change. Now, obviously, that's a, you know, statistical sort of question that's not so easy to answer. But the people that I talk to say that's a very realistic. They have models of disease transmission and everything, and the climate and the insect vectors that carry the diseases are part of those models. Now, that being said, you can do a lot about malaria itself just with, you know, mosquito nets and you know, insecticides and things like that. And so I have heard the argument that instead of paying to reduce CO2 emissions, we should just pay for mosquito nets. I don't think the tropical diseases are the main reason why we want to worry about changing the climate.
Okay, now let's talk about the thrust of your book, which talks about the future, up to 100,000 years into the future. Well, first of all, let's talk about the coming decades. What's happening with the temperature on the Earth? Projections out to 50 years, 100 years. Some people say that on a scale of decades, major metropolitan cities like New Orleans, Boston, New York, San Francisco could be partially underwater. So what are the projections for, let's say, 50 to 100 years?
Well, one of the big uncertainties there is what we do with CO2 emissions and energy, but you can take as a baseline just to talk about what they call a business as usual scenario, which is a projection of how much energy people will need and how much fuel they will burn to get it if there were no constraint from changing climate. And the temperature changes responding to that would put the Earth warmer than it has been in millions of years. So saying what exactly the impacts of that would be on, you know, the corn harvest in Iowa or something like that is really not a very easy thing to do. With respect to sea level, the question is all how quickly can the major ice sheets respond to the changes in climate? The models that have been developed in the past don't respond nearly as strongly as the observations that glaciologists actually can make in Greenland and Antarctica about how the ice streams flowing into the ocean respond to the changes in climate. You can measure more ice quakes in Greenland with seismometers than you could 5 years ago. And the ice sheets, the ice streams flowing from the ice sheets into the ocean are accelerating. So it's really kind of anybody's guess how long it takes for sea level to change. There were events in the past called Heinrich events, when the Laurentide ice sheet, which was in North America, every 8,000 years or so during the last ice age, would just collapse into the ocean. And there would be this armada of icebergs in the North Atlantic, and they would carry little rocks and sand and stuff like that that would then deposit on the seafloor, and there's no way for those to get there other than these icebergs. And so that's how we know about these events today, is by finding those layers of rocks on the bottom of the Atlantic. Those seemed like they took a century or a few centuries, and they seem, some of them, to have raised sea level by many meters, which is much more than any of the ice sheet models predict for the global warming climate event. But I think most everybody thinks that these ice sheet models are just lacking some essential physics at this point.
Well, some people say that the real problem with sea level rise is simply the thermal expansion of ocean water with the rising temperature of the Earth. And since the Earth is rising in temperature, the oceans are going to expand no matter what happens to the North Pole or the South Pole.
Well, that's absolutely true, and that's part of the forecast for sea level rise by the year 2100, which is about a half a meter or so. Something like half of that sea level rise is caused by exactly this effect, the expansion of the seawater. It's like the mercury in the thermometer that fills up more of the thermometer when the temperature goes up. That's a process that will keep going for centuries. So the forecast for the year 2100 is not sort of the end of the line. That's sort of just the beginning for the thermal expansion of seawater. The other half of the sea level rise that's actually in the IPCC forecast for the year 2100 is melting of smaller mountain glaciers like in the Andes and the Alps. And actually, a lot of the sea level rise today can be attributed to mountain glaciers in the state of Alaska. It just happens to be a place where there's lots of ice frozen on mountains and where the climate changes are very intense. But it's some astonishingly large fraction of the sea level rise comes from Alaska.
Okay,
just out of curiosity.
Okay, so what does that mean for the average person who has to make decisions, enormous decisions, in the next few years about fossil fuel consumption, about investment in solar energy, and so on and so forth? What changes in their lifestyle should we expect in the coming decades?
Well, lifestyles could change because we adapt to new energy technologies. Most of the CO2 emissions that can be avoided in the next few decades actually come from improvements in efficiency.
Well, unfortunately, that's it for Exploration. Once again, we had two special guests today. The first special guest was Dr. Peter Ward, author of the book Flooded Earth. And the second guest was Dr. David Archer, author of the book The Long Haul. And this is Exploration with Dr. Michio Kaku. And if you want to get a copy of today's program, call the Pacifica Program Service at 1-800-735-0230. Once again, for a copy of today's program, call the Pacifica Program Service at 1-800-735-0230. Good day.